Hi again. My name is Peter Donat. I'm a business development director at Barco, and as your host today, I'm going to welcome you here to our webinar, How Can Technology Enable You to Create an Immersive Experience? I'm glad to see such a great turn up, even in these difficult times where we are facing a global crisis. And apart from a disease which has the complete attention of the world, I believe we have a quite interesting session for you prepared as well. So first of all, let me introduce the three members of our panel today. To start, we have Augustin. Augustin works for Culture Espace. Culture Espace was the first private actor in France for the management of monuments and museums, which also started to create their own art centers and immersive digital exhibitions worldwide. The mission statement of the company states, transmitting our artistic and cultural heritage to as many people as possible, fostering a culture of excellence, innovation, promoting creativity. So I believe that says it all. Augustin de Conté is the head of the digital department, which is responsible for the immersive exhibition venues, such as Atelier de Lumière in Paris, Carrière de Lumière in the Provence, Bassin de Lumière in Bordeaux, opening soon. So next to him, we have Yannick. He's from Modulo Pi. Good afternoon, Yannick. Modulo Pi is a design and manufacturer of media service solutions. The company's headquarters is in France, close to Paris. And Modulo Pi systems are used in varied applications, including corporate events, museums, theme parks, and concert touring. Yannick Kuhn is the founder and CEO of Modulo Pi, and in the past, he worked on one of the very first media servers more than 15 years ago, before starting Modulo Pi later on. And then last but not least, we have Leander. Leander Werbroek is the Barco segment lead for our fixed install markets for theme parks and museums worldwide, using Barco's different product ranges from LED to LCD through image processing and, of course, projection. He's already a long time with Barco and having worked with digital signage and LED product groups in the past. So I wish to welcome our complete panel and let's get cracking. But first, let's have a quick look at our agenda for today. First of all, we'll have a look at the trends in the museum. With Leander, so to see what is the current movements we see in the museum world. Then we are going to see immersive or digital storytelling. How does it take form? We go to see technology as an enabler. What do we want to solve really with technology? And then at last part, we will see a sneak preview of the new Bassin de Lumière, which will be opening soon. And then there's place and time for questions and answers. If you might have a question during the session, please fill them in the chat. And then at the end of the session, I will take them on and ask them to our panel members. And then please mute during the session, as most of you already did. So thank you very much. And therefore, I can give the word to Leander for the first part. Leander.
All right. Thank you, Peter. Thank you for the introduction. And thank to you all for joining us today. Very much appreciate your attendance. So first and foremost on the agenda, trends in museums. And before starting off on the trends, let us perhaps start with a bold statement about the true challenge for museums today. And the statement goes as follows. Our competition is Netflix and Candy Crush, not other museums. Now, the statement confirms that museums traditionally might not have been a competitive market, but today they are fighting for the attention. And that fight is very often against easy consumable entertainment like Netflix or Candy Crush, just two examples, who are very different in nature, but do provide a broad catalog of entertainment right at your doorstep or on your mobile phone at any time of the day. So why go out and work your way through traffic to be looking at a piece of art, a painting, or to be educated about history when you can have a similar experience in high definition at your own convenience? Now, that's the question that we're going to help you answer today. And we'll do that by zooming in first on the trends and recent signals of how the museum market is adopting change and building resilience. So what key trends do we recognize in the market? First and foremost, let me add here that what we will be highlighting is a reflection, or a snapshot if you like, of trends that we have seen in the past year in the market. Of course, there are many other evolutions going on today, which can certainly be added onto this, but let's focus on these three key trends for starters. Also, don't forget, we have an ebook online for you to download, so feel free to visit our website and get your copy. Now, on trends, the first major trend is what we call music. As pointed out in the introduction, museums need to remain relevant, and technology helps them to do so. Technology enables the way audiences can participate, engage, and learn. And an essential technology is audiovisual. And why is it essential? Well, it's proven that visual information supported by audio allows for quicker learning and higher degree of retention of that information. So technology, of course, goes far beyond the AV part as well. We are looking into a future where augmented reality, virtual reality, and even robotics will further erase the thin lines between the physical environment and the digital stream of content and data available. A second trend is about the location of museums. Traditionally, museums have found themselves in cities or attached to historical sites. Now, in the future, that will most likely not change overnight. But what is changing, though, is the accessibility, especially in cities, but equally important, the cost of operating many square meters of space. So while museums have, of course, a social responsibility, the economical value is also key. And hence, cooperations with brands, corporates, or cities who have the sometimes abandoned or underutilized space are becoming more attractive. So arguably, the location could very well be the best asset the museum has and the strongest enabler going forward. Third and finally, and this is of course not a big surprise, we need to talk about social engagement and the impact social media has on how you position and are perceived in a fast moving world. Moving on, let's first dive a bit deeper on MuseTech. Now, as said, the adoption of technology in a museum in support of a story that is being told is not necessarily a new trend. In past few years, we came to recognize the true added value of technology and also saw a mature result and success it can bring. Of course, technology only brings that result if you rely on the right solutions or partners, but more importantly, if it's done in a non-intrusive way. And that's an important point. Technology should be a means to an end, and it should not take the pole position. Sometimes technology will be visible, but more often it'll go even without being noticed. And that's exactly the whole point. Additionally, technologies also need to be reliable, as they are essential to generate consistent immersion to ensure your guests are kept engaged at all times. Some examples are given here in this slide. On the left-hand side, you see a multi-viewer immersive display setup that allows for groups of visitors to simultaneously step through the story and, in a fully interactive, fun, and educating way, use the components at hand to bring to life their very own personal experience. Note that the technology in this example is a dome, a curved screen with a projection. But it's not hard to imagine this being done at a larger scale for larger groups. The second example on the right upper corner is a projection mapping in a hospitality area. And as we all know, the visitor's journey does not start at the doorstep of the museum. Online, the visitors have probably already been triggered to visit your museum, either from friends who reviewed it, the likes or other forms of appreciation that is happening online. And once engaged to spend time at the location, you want to extend that journey in all possible ways. That means that from the outside of your building, all the way into the lobby, the hospitality area, or into the auditorium that might be at hand, you want to continue with the same atmosphere and add highlights where needed. And lastly, down right in the corner here, we already learned that addressing human eyes is important as visual information is retained quicker than any other information. However, a single screen and a visual experience related to that single screen is not always the right choice. In the end, we are complex beings, and the more information, how subtle it may be, we get, the better we are able to relate and engage with the story that's being told. So audio, motion, or even smell do very much contribute to the story. An example of an emerging technology where different technologies in the end are combined is what we call group VR or group virtual reality, whereby multiple viewers simultaneously cooperate using immersive displays with layers of virtual reality on top. And it can be assisted by, for instance, head-mounted devices. Moving forward on the second trend, what we call recycled architecture. Well, architecture is an art form on itself, right? Now, using technology such as projection, but also direct view LED, that technology or that architecture can be augmented and you can truly add a layer on top to turn both the inside and out into a stunning experience. Simply using the physical walls as a canvas for light creates a dimension of immersion and a wow experience unlike anything else. In the picture shown here, you can see the before and after, to the left the before and to the right, of course, the after, of the location in Paris used by Culture Espace for their groundbreaking Atelier de Lumière. It's a clear example of how heritage is brought to life and how a dialogue is actually established between the 19th century industrial Paris, painters from different areas and their works, and the actual visitors that come in. It's essential to understand that the trend of reusing or repurposing locations is happening globally as urbanization continues and real estate becomes more than ever before expensive, particularly in larger cities. So when choosing a location, it's important to also keep in mind what fit there can be for the technology and to consider if that technology is versatile enough to allow you to reinvent your venue in a flick of the switch and by that recurrently build appealing immersive shows that in the end also financially make sense in the long term. One venue can become multiple destinations and can extend its functionality by also being a spot for co-workers, for studying, for workshops, informal meetups, corporate events, or even live shows. Lastly, in terms of trends, and very important, of course, is the social media. And some of you might cheer and say, hooray, we all know all about social media. Others perhaps are not too sure. And given the vast amount of tweets, likes and shares and whatever else is going on around there, it is indeed hard to sometimes follow. Millennials are constantly looking for a one perfect selfie, a unique story they can share, or a cool quote that they can throw out supported by a highly likable Instagram picture. But don't fear if today you're not seeing the full benefit yet of full social engagement and how it could work for your organization. It can go in small steps. Take an example of some large museums that have in recent months and years changed their policies and now allow photography in parts of their collections. And in this way, they unlock their artwork and they enable audiences to become the proxy for their story. So a Van Gogh, a Magritte, Monet, or any other piece of art can now also have many, many gatherers and many, many followers going into a wave of popular culture through their young online admirers. In addition, short-term thrill seekers will surely want to be part of a next pop-up installation that just landed in the city. And that's perhaps a key idea to work on if you're looking for a seasonal differentiator. So as always, social is about exposure and a feeling of exclusivity, and mastering it will truly help you exponentially grow followers. Now, to close off on the part on the trends, I do want to give you a last message. And it's about a recap of how important AV can be and how important immersive installations in general are. Because the key word here is reach. And reach is about extending and having a deeper impact and more influence in a fast evolving world. So pushing yourself for scale can be done through a unique identity at a global level by creating immersive experiences that are liked and shared also online. With that, I thank you very much for listening to the trends part, and I'm happy to hand it over to Augustin, who will now provide you a much more deeper dive behind what Culture Espace is doing. Augustin, over to you.
Thank you, Leander. Hello, everybody. I'm very pleased to speak about our job in Culture Espace. As Peter said, Culture Espace is the first French private actor for global management of monuments and museums, for the creation of art centers and the organization of temporary classical exhibitions, but also immersive digital exhibitions. In order to perfect the experience, we directly manage all the services offered to the visitor: reception, ticket sales, cultural programs, cultural gift shops, tea shops, catering, garden maintenance, and so on. This management is carried in a network with various types of venues, a museum and art center, classic ones like Musée Jacques Morandré in Paris or Musée Mayol, prestigious historic monuments such as the Nîmes Amphitheater or the UNESCO Roman Theater in Orange, remarkable gardens and collections, and also digital art centers such as Atelier des Lumières in Paris. With Culture Espace Digital, Culture Espace is a leading leading cultural operator with specialized teams and comprehensive expertise, combining the design and the creation of digital art centers, the technological competence for the diffusion of exhibition production, a catalog of immersive digital exhibition, and the presentation of classical, modern, and contemporary artists. The Culture Espace Digital Immersive Art Center attracted last year 7,750,000 people last year. In different places, you can see in the slides, Atelier des Lumières in Paris, Bunker de Lumière in Jeju Island with our partner Timonet, the Carrière de Lumière in Les Baux-de-Provence, and furthermore, you see on the left side, Les Bassins de Lumière in Bordeaux, we will open in this year, and tomorrow maybe New York, Dubai, Copenhague, Brussels, and so on. What we want in this side is to approach freshly to art, because the original works of art by the world's greatest artists are eternal, but they are still dispersed in museums and in collections around the world. Only temporary exhibitions bring together some of these works, but only for several months. Wherever the country, it's very rare for more than a third of the population to be able to have access to this exhibition. But today's technology gives us the opportunity to provide new ways of bringing these works together and enabling them to be discovered by the public in order to share with them with a much wider audience of all ages and far from longer durations. This is a new way of disseminating cultures that Culture Espace had decided to develop with digital technology in France and abroad, while continuing to offer excellence in the dissemination of art. Our new conception is a complete immersion of our visitors in the work of greatest artists of the history of art. Indeed, we want to share a certain outlook on artists. Designed to be digital shows, the exhibition are created using images of projected pictures, which are animated in a very precise way. Our exhibition are conceived by artists who are connoisseurs of history of art and of immersive art. The experience is heightened by a selection of music carefully chosen for the show. Lasting 35 minutes, each long exhibition is continually projected in the place, enabling visitors to visit them whenever they wish. The unique approach to the works, done to the smallest details, facilitates their appreciation. Each show is produced using several thousand HD images and the latest softwares and projection equipment. The combination of profound artistic culture with the mastery of digital animation techniques really transmits the timeless. So our value are artistic genius made accessible to all, a veritable artistic work, and listen to the air breath of each site. Indeed, we want to write a new episode of the history of the venue we are responsible for. We select venues with a strong identity. We select them for their deep soul, their unique qualities and monumental dimensions, but each venue plays a crucial role in the experience. Consequently, as it is adapted to the specific site, the exhibition highlights the venue's architecture. We want these places to be ideal for strolling around, and visitors are encouraged to adopt a participative approach to engage a unique experience. Indeed, it is a new way to continue the history of a former brownfield site. Atelier de Lumière was a foundry to the 16th, Carrière de Lumière a stone quarry to the 40s, and Bassin des Lumières a former World War II German submarine base. We are also working on old banks, old breweries, and so on. We want to write a new episode in the history, and we are indeed interested in the site, but above all in the soul of these places. For example, in Provence, Carrière de Lumière. This immersive art center has become an essential venue in Provence. The Carrière de Lumière are located in the foot of the town of Les Baux-de-Provence, not far from Avignon. It was established itself as a place for transversal experimentation and cultural dissemination for dance and cinema. And since 2012, Culture Espace has been holding digital exhibitions that immerse the visitors in the pictorial world of greatest artists. The projection surface spans 7,000 square meters from the floor to the ceiling, to the height of up to 16 meters. Second example, the Atelier de Lumière in Paris. The Atelier de Lumière is the first digital art center in Paris, established in a former 19th century foundry that has been entirely restored. With 140 video projectors and a specialized sound system, this multimedia equipment is used on a surface area of 3,300 square meters, extending from the floor to the ceiling, with walls up to 10 meters high. The Atelier des Lumières has become one of the most important cultural sites in Paris, using the digital revolution to promote artistic creativity. Indeed, our installations are balanced between a completely automatic management program for multi-screen production and sound and lightning, video equipment that are quite unique because in each we have more than 100 computer-controlled video projectors. We project image onto walls that are up to 20 meters in height. Special audio adapted to the constraints of the site to create the best possible musical experience. Architectural lighting to reveal our venues, which are chosen for which can be plunged into complete darkness during the show. And the one aspect that matters is emotion. All our technical job must be the most precise and accurate as possible in order to let people dream and enjoy. That's why we use technology, the best one, but just as a tool. Technology is a real question for us. Is technology end or means? Which comes first? Projection, visual effects, artistic content? Please just have a look on several video mapping experiments. Some are very good, others very bad. So there is a question about technology. Where is the red line between highlighting by technology, creating new artistic emotion and effect for itself, and with the risk of kitsch and so on? The second danger is juggernaut. Always better, always brighter, always more immersive. But how far do we go? There is a real challenge between not going far enough, being old-fashioned and the risk of competition on one hand, and going too fast, too much, losing our soul in the second hand. The answer is to have a strict common thread. Substance prevails over form. The second answer is to have more accurate tools. Technology must not be a problem to focus our attention on creativity. The real challenge is definitively to hold visitors up. Thanks to artistic emotion. This is a permanent requirement. And all of the challenge, question of money, technology, organization, are corollaries. Indeed, we want to clear a new way to reach cultural offer. We don't want any more people spending their time to sleep in boring exhibitions. We want young people to discover art, poor people to discover art, ultra-connected people to discover art, and so on. In our venues, visitors are taken on an exceptional sensorial and artistic journey and are introduced to a new way, an enduring way of apprehending artists and their works. Our hope is that discovering our digital exhibition is a truly unique artistic experience. This is a physical and intense emotional experience as one builds a masterpiece and have marked history of art. That's why we decided to create some kind of digital museums. Thanks to made-to-measure projects that provide active, entertaining, and suitable learning, our digital sites are the best tool we have to help global public, but children in particular, to discover artistic treasures and help them to construct their lives through cultural activities. Last but not least, our sites are real talent scouts thanks to their reputation. And we pay special attention to young artists to whom we borrow a numeric palette during festival and special events. It is very important for us, for the principle, and because tomorrow is now.
Okay, thank you, August, and thank you very much. Very insightful. Now, moving forward, let's talk a bit about technology as an enabler. And to start off, what I want to do is show you very briefly a couple of typical questions that us technologists are encountered with. And what you read here is typically things that have to do not so much with the creative aspect of the experience, but more about how you operate it, if it can be done cost effectively, and how much work that actually goes in there. So often we as technology partners find ourselves in the position whereby we get built in to not just design the technical aspect, but also support the feasibility from a cost point of view. This is of course related to, as said, to the purchase of the equipment, but also the operational aspects and the general insights on sustainability, achieving the right quality are equally essential. So what is the main message behind technology? Well, I think the key message is one of co-creation. In order to achieve great and long-lasting results, you need a shared vision and a stunning content supported in the end by top-notch technology such as a media platform and perfect visualization. These four elements together, the vision as explained by Augustin, together with stunning content, thanks to the artwork that we can rely on, but then again combined with technology, in the end creates the wow experience. Now, with that, I'm very pleased to hand it over to Yannick at ModuloPi for a deeper dive on the media platform and media server aspect.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. So Horticulture's Past Digital Venue rely on our Modulo Kinetic media server. So you have about 25 servers in Les Bassins de Lumière and about 35 at the Atelier de Lumière in Paris. For a successful immersive experience, we think the AV system must provide the following points. First, IOS capability. Second, usability. And finally, the last one, to be future-proof. So first, we are going to talk about IOS capabilities. When we talk about media server, most of the time we think about media playback, edge blending, and warping, but it's just the tip of the iceberg. For such a massive project like Les Bassins de Lumière, you will need more. And Augustin and Culture Espace Digital choose Modulo Kinetic because our solution is more than a media server. You can use Modulo Kinetic across your complete workflow. So you can do the show study, the 3D simulation, and do all the show control inside directly. And it's a good way to reduce the number of devices and software you are working with. So less hardware and less software means your system is more reliable and easier to use. This will help reduce complexity and save a lot of time. First, you need a solution adapted for such massive projects. To create the immersive experience, you will need to project on all walls on the floor. So your media server solution needs to be capable of dealing with very large canvas. We talk about 200 million pixels for Les Bassins de Lumière. So you need to place this content seamlessly across a large number of projectors. It's important to have the ability to control any number of synchronized media servers from one user interface. To create the immersive experience, you need one image seamlessly running over the venue. This means your media server will need to have the right tools for edge blending and geometry. Modulo Kinetic embeds 3D warping tools, but this means you need a very accurate 3D scan of your venue. And all of this implies time, budget, and specific skills. On the other end, on a complex building, it's difficult to work with 2D mapping and use only a single warping grid projector. So to solve this, Modulo Kinetic embeds a specific 2D warping tools. It's called the XMAP function. In short, it will allow you to split a complex warping into small, independent, easy-to-do warping. And using these warping tools, you can easily and perfectly adjust your content to the architecture of your venue. Also, to save time, you need to have a multi-user warping remote that you can use close to the projection surface. Now let's talk about the second point, the usability. You need to make sure your media server gives you the right tools to deal with the daily management of your venue. For example, real-time compositing tools will allow you to mix media, adjust the color level of any media, and so on. So you need to be able to do a lot of things on site. And with this, you will save time and simplify your workflow. So now let's talk about show control. Having an embedded show control will help you to easily control all your devices, including your barcode projectors, from one single user interface. In addition, you can control and monitor your overall system thanks to panels. You can create these panels with simple drag and drop. Let's talk about our last point. I mean the future proofness. As we already said, your system needs to be easily scalable. For example, if you need to add more projectors in the future, you can easily add some more servers in your system. In addition, you need to think about how you can improve the visitor experience. And Modulo Kinetic already embeds tools for tracking and interactivity. The audience could be able to interact with the projection and spatial audio. And thanks to this fully integrated approach, we keep the same software, which means the system is less complex, more responsive, and reliable.
All right. Thank you very much, Yannick. Very insightful as well on the media platform. And allow me perhaps to repeat a couple of the key messages that Yannick was bringing, particularly on the quality throughout the fully integrated system and also the reliability. Because these two elements are exactly what also Barco's displays are all about in the end. Keep in mind that ultimately, your audience only sees the end result and the output of that very display. So whether you're using projection, LED, or LCD displays, the intent should be to cater to all needs and to offer a wide enough range of options to go along with creative concepts while guaranteeing still the near perfection and the high image quality. When talking about projection, as used by Culture Espace in this example, we can highlight that a level of hyper-realistic reproduction of the content is only achieved through the use of laser projection. This technology is the only one in its kind that allows for highest level of details and accuracy, most natural color reproduction at any brightness level, and that's important. So whether it's indoor or outdoor solutions that you're looking for, the brightness level with a good level of quality in reproduction is what you need. But let's also talk about service and serviceability, because that's actually also a very important key to success. So before closing the technology chapter of this webinar, I'd like to raise a warm call to action on this. A call to action that is aimed at putting the topic of service and serviceability on the table when you are involved in creating immersive experiences for museums. Service is essential to ensure that the total cost of ownership is under control and can actually be fully estimated at the start of a project. Yes, machines and solutions today have many different features on board, and yes, they allow to almost fully automatically run a whole show. Nonetheless, too often it is forgotten, and an assumption is made that when it is needed and something should go wrong, that still you need to be able to quickly intervene at a low cost. So, in order to be prepared, you can rely on a lot of features, but still you have to make agreements on service and take the serviceability into account in case of unexpected events. So don't hesitate to talk about this with your AV partner and ask the question on total cost of ownership and service throughout the full lifetime of an installation. Moving forward, this is the end of the technology as an enabler part of the agenda. And let's move back to Augustin, who will briefly talk to you about Bassin de Lumière and give you an interesting sneak preview on what's coming up. Augustin, over to you.
Thank you. So I will speak about our new project in Bordeaux, southwest of France, in a former submarine base. You can see some picture here on the left side, the original use in the 40s, and nowadays the test we had last month. Located in Bordeaux, the submarine base was built by the Germans, and it was one of the first major structures constructed in France during World War II. This massive bunker, arranged in 11 pools, will now become an essential part of Bordeaux's cultural landscape. The construction of this base commenced in September 1941. Around 6,500 French and foreigners, Spanish, Belgian, and Italian voluntary, contracted or forced laborers, worked on the base, which was extensive enough to accommodate 15 large submarines. Finished only 1.5 years later, Bordeaux's U-boat bunker was 235 meters long, almost 160 meters wide, and on average 19 meters high, with a total surface area of 41,000 square meters. It housed electrical and thermal power plants, a technical zone, offices, storage areas, and workshops. Almost 600,000 cubic meters of concrete was used to build this building. Since 2018, Culture Espace had implemented a major project to enhance and develop the fourth bastion in the submarine base, entrusted to it by the city of Bordeaux. The Bassin des Lumières represents monumental immersive digital exhibitions devoted to the major artists of the history of art and contemporary art. The digital exhibition will perfectly adapt the monumental architecture of the submarine base and will be reflected in the water of the four enormous pools, thereby adding the new dimension of the immersive experience. You can see it on the picture, and when the image is moving, the effect is better and better. In addition to restoration work and restoration of the site, floors, tanks, foundation, electricity, superproofing, etc., and the creation of technical areas, offices, production rooms, servers, and so on, Culture Espace has decided to develop the site in order to improve the visitors' experience. The pool's era will be concealed by enormous 15 meters high trampolines, will be also used at projection surface. And originally, the basin had only one gangway. It was renovated and two additional gangways were added in order to facilitate access, increase the itinerary floor space for visitors, and increase the number of viewpoints. You can see it on the picture in the middle. Several challenges had to become due to the history of the base, an old building gang, and the presence of the water that is 6 meters deep. The projector will be located inside air-conditioned cases, and each speaker will be independently swivelled and controlled in order to control the flow of sound and adapt the quality of the audio content. Each of these elements, which respects and preserves the original site, contributes to creating the experience offered by Bassin des Lumières. In terms of figure, Bassin des Lumières represents 200 million pixels, 80 projectors, majoritarily Barco F-Series and UDX, 55 speakers, 25 subwoofers, and 200 kilometers of optical fibers. So it's very huge, and because the air on the base is steamy and a bit salty because of the proximity of the ocean, we need waterproof boxes and so on. So it was a very huge work, and 2 years later, after major restoration work, the Bassin des Lumières will open its door to the public, but as soon as possible.
All right. Thank you again, Augustin. I'm very much looking forward to visiting this. I think we're at the end of what we had prepared for you. Thanks again for listening to this part already.
Thank you very much for joining, and we'll speak soon. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.